going inside the issues of our community. This is Local 12 Newsmakers.
They sprang up, surrounding America's bustling, crowded cities, yet were far enough away to offer open space and fresh air. They were the first suburbs.
A new documentary that focuses on two greater Cincinnati suburbs, Madeira and Elmwood Place, raises important national issues.
The same government policies of outward expansion that helped build the first suburbs are undermining them today.
So we're on the edge of rethinking what the American dream means. And I think first suburbs and their challenges are evidence of a crack in the pavement.
Good morning and welcome to Local 12 Newsmakers. When a spotlight is focused on the problems facing urban centers and inner city neighborhoods, it often leaves the impression that everything is okay in the suburbs. In fact, urban scholars have been raising alarms for several decades about the challenges facing what are called first suburbs. Two new videos made for public television explore the dilemmas faced by first suburbs. One, entitled The New Neighbors, will be screened for the first time this Friday evening at UC. Details on that later in the show. And the other, A Crack in the Pavement, focuses on two greater Cincinnati suburbs, Madeira and Elmwood Place. That is our focus this morning. To discuss the challenges faced by these two suburbs, I am joined this morning by Andrea Torrice, the producer of both documentaries. Ms. Torrice is a resident of Clifton, has won acclaim for her work Rising Waters on the crisis facing the global environment, and Forsaken Cries, the story of Rwanda. Thomas Moeller is the city manager of Madeira, and Richard Ellison is the mayor of the village of Elmwood Place. Welcome to Newsmakers. Tom, welcome back.
And thank you.
You've been here actually to talk about first suburbs in the past. And Andrea, welcome.
Thank you.
You are the producer. Why is it, now you live in Clifton, but you haven't always lived in Cincinnati. How did you end up choosing these two communities to focus on to highlight some of the issues in first suburbs? Because from an outsider's point of view, Madeira and Elmwood Place would look like two places don't have anything in common.
They have a lot in common, although one is a little bit newer than the other. And also the geographic configuration of Elmwood Place was the main street, Vine Street, that street that's so important to you, to the nation, Main Street USA. And I thought that also the characters were perfect. I thought that both Richard and Tom could tell the story of what was happening. Also, Madeira is a classic white-collar bedroom community, which is very, which many American communities have a bedroom. And also, Elmwood Place is a more traditional Main Street older suburb.
Yeah, sort of working class, older class.
Yes.
Suburb in the valley. I live much of my life in Northside, which isn't that much different than Elmwood Place. Tom, you've, as I just mentioned before, you've been on the show talking about the first suburbs movement, the first suburbs issues. Is this something that is gaining attention in our region? Is it something that's gaining attention in Columbus? Is this something that's getting traction places?
We believe so. We've certainly seen a lot more involvement with the suburban communities around Cincinnati. We have an organization now that encompasses a couple of dozen suburbs, first suburbs of Cincinnati. And I think in Columbus and in Washington, D.C., we're seeing some I'm going to refer to it as sympathy to our plight. There really hasn't been any outward implementation of any of the recommendations that we've had so far, but they're at least recognizing that we do have some problems that need to be addressed in the future.
Mayor, has Elmwood Place been involved in this effort to raise attention about first suburbs for some time, or are you new to this effort?
No, I'm on the board of the first suburbs,
okay.
the local board, and we've been trying for the last couple of years, actually the last two or three years, we've been very involved in trying to get help, make people aware what the first suburbs problems are, what our particular problems are, and to see if we can't get some attention to the people, particularly in the state legislature, who seem to be forgotten where they come from.
Well, we're going to have, in the second part of the show, we're going to talk about where we're going to go, but let's explore some of the issues. And I want to pull some elements out of the documentary so that people get some sense of the dynamic. Here is how Tom Moeller sets up the dilemma facing Madeira in the documentary, A Crack in the Pavement.
Classic first suburbs community. We had a lot of development immediately after World War II in the late 1940s and 1950s. Much of the development was subsidized by the federal government, and those development funds went to build virtually all of the infrastructure: roads, sewers, water lines, schools, culverts. Anything that was associated with public infrastructure was done with those development dollars. The funding that was available back in the 1950s and 1960s from both the state and federal government is no longer available today. Madeira, like most first suburbs communities, is losing population. As a result, we lose tax revenue. There's a very vicious downward spiral that takes place. We lose population, the tax rates have to go up, we drive out more population because the tax rates go up, and also too, Madeira doesn't become as attractive for commercial development because commercial development wants to follow where the population goes.
So this cycle of falling population, need to raise taxes to address basic services, which then only encourages people to move out. This is the issue that all first suburbs are really facing, right?
Absolutely.
This is the cycle. And one of the other parts is that, and this is a little bit different with Elmwood Place, but in Madeira, being a bedroom suburb, you never had that industrial or business tax base.
That's correct. We've always relied on a residential tax base, and it's a classic dilemma of urban policy that residential tax bases generally don't provide the level of revenue necessary to provide services and support the infrastructure.
You know, one of the things that I found interesting about, and the reason I selected that particular bite, was people tend to forget the importance of government investment in the development of communities. Sort of the attitude that we did this on our own. You make the point that there was a lot of government investment for Madeira when it was developing. It's just now it's out in the farther out, the edge suburbs.
That's correct. And that's, again, I don't want to use the word abandonment of our first suburbs. But in essence, that's what's happened, is that once the development has taken place, once the infrastructure is in place, then the subsidization moves farther out, and we're left to maintain what was put into place at that particular time. And as I said, our revenue will never be able to support at a 100% level all of the services that are necessary, as well as all of the maintenance of the infrastructure.
Andrea, you, by focusing on these kinds of suburbs, did you also think about really exploring with state officials, you know, how they are thinking about this and the politics of this? Because population has moved to the suburbs, farther and farther out suburbs, but it's moved to the suburbs. So cities in general and metropolitan areas, they've lost clout in state capitals. That's part of this whole thing.
Yes, it is part of this whole thing, and I think why I did not focus specifically on specific state legislation or issues so that it could be more of a national story here in Ohio, I think that Ohio and what's happening here is a bellwether, a really good signal to the country as to how we need to rethink what our policies are doing to our communities, our older communities, as well as, especially with the current economic situation, rethink what the new metropolis needs to look like, our housing markets, how we fund transportation, how we fund our infrastructure, because what you see is this cycle of outward expansion and then abandonment, And we have in Cincinnati, which is a very classic problem to many regions in the Northeast and Midwest, which is we have hyper sprawl and spatial segregation, where as we've moved out, we have been forgetting about our older older communities, and we need to rethink our policies that can then help revitalize these places.
You know, if we don't want to use the word abandonment, because I think that has all sorts of, you raised a question about that. We could think of this as disinvestment, though.
Absolutely.
Definitely on that. Absolutely. Now, I want to shift over to Elmwood Place, and I'm going to, from the documentary, allow the mayor to set this up. So let's take a look at another section from the documentary.
Elmwood Place Village is another first suburb of Cincinnati, not far from Madeira. It was once a vibrant trolley suburb where working-class families lived. People started leaving in the 1970s when the interstate highway was built and the trolleys were removed.
Shoppers used to say, if you can't find it in Elmwood, you can't find it. We had over 100 stores that were of all varieties, shapes, and sizes, and people used to come from all over the valley to shop here. Of the 100 stores we had, practically all of them are now closed. It's a very sad situation. But that's the situation we're in today.
Mayor, so this focuses on your shopping district. And for many of these first suburbs, they were built around shopping districts. What's it mean to a community not to be able to sustain that sort of center? You know, Elmwood Place is still there. People are still living there. What's it mean to lose that sort of center?
Well, when it's the very center, really, and it's the ultimate in of the community as far as survival, it's devastating. It is. We had 102 stores at one time. We may have 8 businesses on Vine Street now.
Wow.
And they're not very viable. They're there. We used to have a number of industries in Elmwood. They've dropped down to about half. So the tax revenue we got from the industries, plus the tax revenue we got from the stores, plus what we got from the vitalization of people coming to Elmwood on a regular basis, because Elmwood was basically a shopping center, is what it was. Within 8 blocks, you had about any kind of store you could name. People came from all over to Elmwood, and it's all gone. The highways was partly responsible for that, and in suburbia, people moving away, younger generation left. And we have all these older homes where the people who lived in Elmwood for years are now gone.
You know, you describe this, and I don't want to get off on a totally different, it's not a totally different topic, it's a related topic, but you describe this as a streetcar community, and you showed the streetcar. We're talking about a streetcar again. Point is, once people get in automobiles and on an expressway and through Elmwood Place, part of that's elevated, you know, you don't get off. You don't get out of your car anymore. You're not stopping. You're not on your way home. You're not going to just say, oh, I got to stop for milk. I got to stop to pick up whatever it is I need. It really changes the dynamic of that neighborhood business district.
Well, the Hamilton County Planning Commission had a meeting a year ago at the zoo, and they had a world famous architect, designer, builder who came and spoke. And he basically said that automobiles have destroyed communities, literally have destroyed communities. And the way the perspective he showed us and how he interchanged everything, it made sense. It brought me a realization of something I had never even thought about. Like you said, you get in your car and you virtually live in your car.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, if you live in a modern suburb that has a garage, you might go out of your house, into your garage, get into your car, drive straight to where you're going to work, park in a parking garage, get out. You never are on the street.
No.
It's not just the streets of Elmwood Place. It's the streets of downtown Cincinnati. Right. It's completely changed the way these places function. As it's also a factor in Madeira, right?
Absolutely. We we see most of our population every morning leave to work in other places and come home at 5 or 6 o'clock at night. And our businesses that we have within our central business district need to rely both on the residents as well as people coming from the outside, and that's just not always happening for them, because people are driving out of the community during the day and coming back late afternoon, early evening, when those businesses may or may not be open.
Right. We have to take a break right now, but stay tuned. After a short break, we'll return to talk about the options for first suburbs in the future.
One of the things that could benefit First Suburbs communities is having a balanced growth policy for the region.
Welcome back. This morning we're discussing the challenges faced by First Suburbs, as highlighted in a new documentary, A Crack in the Pavement. The documentary focuses on Madeira and Elmwood Place here in Hamilton County, but is of national focus. I am joined by Andrea Torrice, the producer of the twin documentaries on First Suburbs, Tom Moeller, the city manager of Madeira, and Elmwood Place's mayor, Richard Ellison. Okay, let's take a little bit of a look at what might be done. And you were saying that you've been working on this for a number of years, not a lot has been implemented yet, but some ideas have been developed. Tom, you hinted at, and the bite I pulled out of the documentary, regional planning. How would that help?
Well, we see regional planning as a first step in making certain that, you know, that development that takes place is not a juxtaposition to everything that's going on within the central city. And we as First Suburbs view ourselves as being part of the central city, because what's taking place around the I-275 belt and beyond is all relatively new development, but it's creating a vacuum within the central city. So if there were some coordination between the planning efforts of what's taking place around the exterior of the region versus what's taking place on the interior of the region, we think that there could be a synergy, if you will, that make sure that our developments and our suburbs are maintained and thriving. There's a vitality to them, along with what's taking place on the outside.
You know, one of the things that strikes me, and it's not said exactly this way, but as I watch the documentary, people can get very excited about building new things. Mm-hmm. But maintaining and continuing to invest in what we have built is very hard to sell to people. They'd love to go out. I mean, and it's not just about this. It's about, you take almost any institution, building that next building or putting an addition on is a lot more fun than maintaining, cutting the grass and maintaining the whatever you've got. And I think that's part of what's going on.
Yes, that is part of it. I like to say that America has, for over 200 years, had this whenever, you know, we could just build on new land. It was the frontier mentality. And now we've hit middle age, as we've hit this century, and we need to rethink how we think about where we live, our communities, and how we grow. And I looked at a lot of malls in the Cincinnati area, and one of the shots that didn't get in this film was that there was a store that was closing, and they were building a new one just over the line of the town, a new store, exactly the same, about half a mile away. Mm-hmm. And the question is, so you have an abandoned mall, and then just a little bit further out was a new mall, and yet we don't have the population or the business to support that kind of
competition. It just transfers.
Competition.
It. Mm-hmm. It yes. just, you kill one and transfer. Mm-hmm. Mayor, one of the things that you mentioned earlier, the Elmwood Place used to have a significant amount of manufacturing. You can say that about a lot of the Valley communities, mm-hmm. but about a lot of Hamilton County. One of the proposals that Myron Orfield, who is one of the scholars who focuses on this and is interviewed in the documentary, one of the proposals he's made is the idea of taking all the industrial revenue, all the tax revenue off industrial property, and rather than letting that just be in one community, whether that be Cincinnati or St. Bernard or whatever, put all of that in a pool and then allow all of the communities, which for suburban first suburbs would really change the dynamic, these residential places. What do you think of that? I mean, it's a place that once had industry, but now have lost a lot about that.
Well, now that we've lost it, it sounds real good. No, seriously, though.
That's right. It's a political reality.
Yeah, if that developed and the administration was on an equitable basis, according to real need, I wouldn't have a problem with it at all. I think it would be very helpful, quite frankly. It would give the vibrant communities some stability, and would give those of us that have decayed an opportunity to rebuild. I look at a community as physical fitness. you know, you begin to build yourself up. You run, you do your exercise, you eat the right foods. But then when you get where you want to go, then you stop. And that's what communities do. You got the new communities that are built, but you've got to keep moving and keep producing and keep improving, or you're just going to decay. There's no question about it.
Tom, what do you think about that idea? And I happen to live in a community that's not incorporated. I live in a township in an area of Springfield Township called Finneytown. There is no, it's all residential. There's no tax base, you know, which makes it crazy. High taxes, very high taxes. What do you think of this idea of trying to share the tax base?
Well, it certainly has worked in a couple of other areas of the country. The obvious problem is getting some consensus amongst all the political leaders that this is the way to go, because the haves versus the have-nots are going to be in conflict with the situation. But you know, again, like Mayor Ellison, you know, we're in a position where the city of Madeira would certainly gain from that kind of proposal, because we have our population is working for the most part in other communities, and we would like to see some of that revenue come back to us.
One of the things that I noticed, Andrea, in the documentary is that these two gentlemen and a number of others, you followed them to Columbus, where they met with a couple of legislators, and there was some real pushback there. Mm-hmm. And I presume that just picking up the spontaneous results of what was said in those meetings. It's kind of interesting.
Well, yes, and it's the reality, which is that there are, it's a very controversial issue here in the state of Ohio. It's not so controversial in other parts of the country. And I think it's
a place like Minneapolis, St. Paul,
yes,
for example.
Yes, and also Louisville has also been trying these new approaches, this regional cooperation, regional transportation planning that has a slightly different focus. And it's a question for the state. Also, Cleveland is beginning to think about a regional strategy. And as our metropolitan areas have grown, the question is some of the key tenets of our legislation still focuses on small towns, which are wonderful in America. It's really the heartbeat of America. And yet maybe it's time for us to think about cooperating on a larger scale. Corporations certainly have done that. Maybe we need our governance model to start thinking that way too.
You know, and you two are in different situations because you're an elected official and you're an appointed official. But, you know, anything that hints of metropolitan government or regionalism is like the third rail of local politics. Right. Anybody who proposes it, you're just about gone. Now, one of the things I want to point out is that this is part of a two-part set of documentaries, and on Friday night, the companion documentary entitled The New Neighbors will be shown at DAAP on the UC campus. It explores the challenge of building sustainable, integrated communities and focuses on Pensauken, New Jersey. Take a look.
There were more whites on the block, and I gotta tell you, the whites were here. When we looked at the house, they were outside looking at us, and we were really kind of wondering, are they going to be friendly, or are they like, you know, what are these black people doing moving in?
It was July the 3rd, 1996. I walked outside to pick up our newspaper, and the home down the street where new African-American neighbors had moved in just probably a couple of months before now had five sale signs, almost like a ring around their home. And all I can say is that I was overwhelmed with sadness. It was clearly white flight. I looked at myself in the mirror that night and I said, well, if you want somebody to do something, you gotta do it yourself. If you want somebody to do something, you better take responsibility. I didn't know what to do. I didn't know how to do it. I just knew that I wanted to live in a town that reflected all the people.
If you are interested in viewing and discussing the New Neighbors documentary, a premiere screening will be available this Friday night in the Kaplan Theater at the College of Design, Art, Architecture, and Planning, DAAP, on the UC campus. The event begins at 6 p.m. If you'd like to make a reservation, go to the Cincinnati Chamber website at www.cincinnatichamber.com. This screening is co-sponsored by a lot of different organizations, and I really congratulate you, Andrea.
Thank you.
And congratulate the two of you for participating in this and the work you're doing on the First Suburbs, and stick with it, and we'll keep following this. And thank you for making Newsmakers a part of your Sunday morning. We end this morning with a thought from UC professor Carla Schifos about the challenge metropolitan regions face with the future of First Suburbs. Have a good week.
We need a vision that will include old and new communities. We need a new American dream for the 21st century.
Oh, I could be dreaming, so boom, if I could take you up and back.